Divine Truth Events. These are events and presentations by Jesus and Mary. This presentation is part of the Human Soul series. The topic is Fear is Your Friend. Presented by Jesus on the 23rd of August 2008 in Eudlo, Sunshine Coast, Queensland, Australia. This is part one.
So how's everyone feeling today?
Good.
Fearful. Well, that's got to come from inside of you somewhere. Yeah. Well, welcome along again. Thank you very much for coming along today. I know all of you have got busy lives that you're involved in, so thank you for sharing your life with me. And today, of course, the subject is Fear is Your Friend. And I wanted to talk about fear a lot because oftentimes what happens is we become so immersed in fear that we can't do our emotional processing work. So who of you are finding, you know there's emotions inside of you, you can feel the law of attraction, attracting different events into your life that's proving to you that emotions are inside of you, but you're finding it very, very difficult to access those emotions. All right? Pretty much everyone, including myself at the moment actually. All right. Well, that being the case, we are all in a state of fear. It is fear, in fact, that prevents you from accessing all emotion. And it's also fear that prevents you from being at one with God. So fear is the thing to actually look at, like what's going on behind the fears. But there's a, who's confronted by the Bible? Who doesn't like hearing anything from the Bible? Okay, well, I'm going to read something from the Bible. Just for you to confront that fear. There's a favourite verse of mine in the Bible. It's in 1 John 4, verse 18. It's in the notes. This is what it says. There is no fear in love, but perfect love throws fear outside, because fear exercises a restraint. Indeed, he that is under fear has not been made perfect in love. Very, very, in fact, it's probably one of my, it is probably the favourite verse that I have in the Bible, actually, that verse. Fear exercises a restraint on you and prevents you from being perfected in divine love. And so we need to look at the dynamics of fear, what's actually going on behind fear. And this is something I've had to do a lot in my own life, right, in terms of coming to terms with all the fears that I've had inside of my own life. And what prevents truth from entering your heart, in other words, what prevents truth from changing your life, is the fear that you desire to hold on to. That's what prevents truth from changing your life. So let's have a look at some of the dynamics of fear. In the pageant messages, there's quite a few things that are mentioned about fear. And I've put in the notes a reference to one of those messages that you might like to read later. But basically it says exactly the same as that Bible verse. That if we are going to be progressed in love to the point of atonement with God, when you become at one with God, you will never fear again. And wouldn't that be a beautiful state to be in, if you can just imagine that for a moment? Just imagine that there is nothing in your life that you ever, ever fear. That you just go ahead and do exactly what you're desiring. It's always harmonious with love and truth. And you are never, ever afraid of making the choice. Imagine how that will change your life. That's a big place. That's a different place to be in, isn't it? But you think about our lives right now. How much of our lives are just so focused on feeling all of these fears and then responding to them? There's so much of it, isn't there? That is focused on that. So you remember the soul. You tell me what the soul is again.
Passions.
So here's the soul. So it's our desires. Emotions, passions, what else?
Aspirations,
personality, and so forth, right? attentions and so forth. Right? There's our soul. We've got two primary influences on our soul. Remember I said that right at the beginning? What are the two primary influences on our soul?
Truth.
Truth?
And
error. My khaki handed. All right. Both of them enter you emotionally. So truth enters you emotionally, and error enters you emotionally. Do you understand what I mean by that? You can have a thought in your head, but unless it's an emotion, it's never going to be real. You follow me? This applies to truth as well as to error. So when you're in truth, when you recognize a certain truth, you can recognize it in your mind, but it's not going to become reality in your heart until you've experienced it. And I quite often liken that to sort of like walking through a wall. Until you've experienced it, you don't really know you can do it, do you? Although, intellectually, it's possible. We're made of atoms, the wall's made of atoms. It should be possible somehow, but because we've never experienced it, we don't know that it's possible until we've done it. And that applies to all truth. The same applies to error, by the way. So all of our errors are inside of us emotionally. And we believe them to be true. And that's where a lot of our resistance comes from. So most of our errors have entered us emotionally, and we need, remember we said as part of our progression in divine love, that we need to release our errors. We need to use our free will to allow ourselves to release all of the errors so that we no longer have them in us. And once we have released the error, the truth can enter us. So let's say I have an error inside of my heart that I'm not lovable. Then obviously that's going to impact on every single interaction I have with every single person in my life until I release that error from me. Once I release that error, I can accept the truth that I am lovable, and ironically, at that same moment, I will start attracting people into my life who actually do love me. Right? Truth and error can't occupy the same place in our soul at the same time. Do you understand what I mean by that? Yeah? You can't say, on one hand, that I'm lovable, but not feel, on the other hand, that you are. Right? So if you're feeling something in your heart, whether you intellectualize it or not, it really makes no difference to what's going to go on with the law of attraction and what's going on with your life. So I think I mentioned to you before that I did 3 years of jogging every day, you know, doing all the affirmation things, you know, the positive affirmation things. You know, I am lovable, I am worthy, you know, all that stuff as you're jogging along, right? And none of it did anything. Because I still felt unworthy inside, and I wasn't willing to release the unworthiness. I wasn't willing to go and dive into the depths of that emotion and release that emotion. And so I was in a state of fear, trying to get my mind to dominate how I was feeling and hoping that something would come about from that. How many of you have done that in your lives? Yeah? It's a very New Age thing, isn't it? Yeah. And it doesn't work very well, does it? You notice that? You notice that every day seems to be an effort when you're doing that. Yeah. So you drag yourself out of bed, put on the running shorts, right? And off you go again, doing the same affirmations as yesterday, but nothing really changes. And nothing can change until this is released from you, emotionally. And the only way you can release it is the same way that a child releases it, and that is by experiencing it, by feeling it, by experiencing it. And it's all of the emotions that we've decided that we can't experience that are locking us down. They are the emotions that are frozen within us, inside of us. They are the emotions that prevent us from growing. So, what do we do with this error? This error becomes so painful in the soul. And usually so painful when we're very, very young, that what we finish up doing is we start putting in these constructions inside of ourselves to prevent ourselves from actually accessing and releasing those emotions. So what we do is we construct these blockages to experiencing our deepest sad and grieving type emotions. That's what we've all done. And we did that at a very, very young age. And why did we do that? Because that's what we were taught to do. Because if you look at what a child does naturally, what do they do naturally? Like, if someone hurts them, what do they do straight away? Just cry. They just experience it. It's only when we start going, no, there, you don't need to cry about that, right, that we're starting to shut them down. It's only when we're going, you stop that or I'll give you something to cry about, that's when we start shutting them down, isn't it? And once all of those things start happening, these emotions then get locked up inside of us. And once they're locked up inside of us, what happens to them is they create then our soul's reality. Everything that is happening around you right now is a direct creation of your own reality, of your own, shall I call it, soul condition, the emotions that are inside of your soul. All right, so let's look at the dynamics of fear, because the fear has to do with this processing of error in particular. Who of you likes nice emotions, like not afraid of nice emotions? Some of you are quite afraid of nice emotions, aren't you? Like, yeah. If they're really intense. Yeah. How many are afraid of intense nice emotions? Okay. Yeah. So you can see that there's some issues there too, isn't there? Even experiencing nice emotions, sometimes we have fears as well. Right. So we need to find out what the source of those fears are. Right. Well, with fear, there's three primary responses. The first one is terror. How many of you have experienced terror in your lives? Yeah? Quite a lot? Particularly when you're in your childhood?
Yes.
Yeah. Deep terror, yeah. Terror is the kind of response where you just literally freeze, where you can't actually do anything. And you can barely even breathe sometimes. Now, to re-experience that, and that is something that you'll need to do if you have terror locked up inside of you. The only way to get through it is to actually breathe diaphragmatically. So that's one response, is terror. Terror will just freeze you in a situation. And it's always related to something in your childhood. Who's afraid of snakes like that? Quite a few. Or spiders? Or mice? I knew this lady who was so afraid of mice, she would collapse on the floor and have a fit, a seizure, as soon as she saw a mouse. And when we started tracing it back, it went back to her childhood and some sexual things that her brothers did to her with creatures. So you can understand why she has some very, very strong fears about, like, mice. And it was just a linkage straight back into a memory, which she couldn't allow herself to experience. Even as an adult, she was in her 40s, and she couldn't allow herself to experience that. So a lot of these events have linkages back into our childhood. So the first one is terror. The next one is, what do we most often do when we're afraid? Run away. Or flee, or flight. So the first one was terror. Terror is a very, very difficult emotion to allow yourself to experience. But it will be a necessary part of the majority of our progressions. Because most of us at some point experience some childhood terror. Right? So the next one is, shall I call it flight? Okay, that's the one we do most of the time, isn't it? Mm-hmm. We're afraid of something, so we get away from it. You're afraid of a certain person, so you stay away from them. You're afraid of certain situations, so you don't involve yourself in those situations. You're afraid of anything that will access something inside of you emotionally. And so what we do is we stay away from it, we just flee them. And the third response is the anger response. Fight. So how many of you do that? As soon as something starts getting triggered, straight into wanting to. Who are more of the flea kind? But both are basically the same sides of, the opposite sides of the same coin, really. They're exactly the same thing, fear being expressed differently. By the way, today with questions, you will need to keep them on topic, all right? Not like our previous discussions.
Where does phobias fit into those three?
I'm talking firstly about when this fear was created in you. What we'll talk about in a minute is how we then emotionally go with these fears. And it's the emotional part of the fear that becomes the phobia. Right? So we'll talk about that and what doctors and professionals say about that and what God says about that as well.
Where does automatic pilot or disassociating from, like, going into staying in that, but just in the spot, not running, not fighting, but disassociating, like?
Usually if a person completely disassociates from an experience, then they're in the, then there's a childhood terror triggering that. So when you, if you go into just automatic pilot and you're not even conscious of what you're doing in that situation, then there's a childlike terror response happening behind the scenes. Who's afraid even just talking about fear? No? Who, what are you feeling right now? So what's that? Isn't that fear? Can you see even just a discussion about fear can actually, I don't know, but I can feel most of your emotions at the moment. And your heart rates are a bit higher than normal. Right? And if you can just allow yourself to breathe. Those of you whose heart rates aren't higher than normal, it's because you're in tune-out mode. Right?
Is anxiety,
and you're very used to it. Anxiety is a fear, yeah. So fears you could sort of have different gradations, if you like, of intensity. Just like anger has different gradations of intensity. So the highest intensity of anger might be like uncontrollable rage. The lowest intensity of anger might be just a slight annoyance. Right? Now, with fear, the highest point of fear is terror. So in other words, frozen terror. And then the lowest point might be just mild anxiety. And there's a huge range in between there. Gary?
So you can use anger to cap fear.
We use anger to get away from our fear a lot of times. Because anger is a more powerful response. So none of you like experiencing a feeling of fear, do you?
No.
We don't usually like it, right? And what we wanted to do today is come to actually love it. We want to do this with it, huh? So that embrace it. That's what we want to do with our fear. But most of us are feeling like we can't do that. We want to what? Reject. We want to push our fear away from ourselves all the time. But fear is a very important part of your progression, and that's what we'll learn about today. All right.
So when you confront your fear, your terror, your rage, and like you're worried about the person, like for instance, it goes back to childhood, and you're speaking to someone that it's going to go directly right back to them, and then you're going to bring out their fear,
yep.
But it holds you back. You know, how do you cross that line? You know?
The key to remember with all of our transactions with other people is that what is happening inside of the other person is something from their childhood and from their experience. So we are not responsible, if we're acting in a loving way, speaking truth, we are not responsible for the other person's reaction to that truth. That's their reaction that comes from their childhood experience and their emotions that they're trying to bottle down. So, and with your own, as long as you stay in your truth, stay connected with your emotions, stay connected with your fears, that's the important thing. Don't start taking responsibility for other people's fears. It's hard enough taking responsibility for your own than it is to also add to those everyone else's. Now, of course, if everyone else is dumping their fear on you, the law of attraction is stating what? that you must have fear within yourself, that you are attracting that those people dumping that fear onto you, right? But always try to keep in mind with yourself that it's all to do with your own fear. It's all to do with what's inside of you. And fear is not really, most fear is not really so much childhood emotion as it is the denial of the childhood emotion. Now I must clarify that, because terror is often a childhood emotion. So we can speak about the differences there. So often when it comes to things like terror, you will need to experience it in a childlike state. Right? But the majority of our fears, where we want to run away or we want to fight, so in other words, we want to flee or get angry, those kind of fears are usually related to the adult's denial of the child's emotion. And when I say the child's emotion, I mean your inner child, if you like, or the frozen emotion that's been frozen in time from your childhood, has been locked down and suppressed, and the adult wants to keep it suppressed in many cases. Wants to keep it under wraps. Doesn't want to experience it. Right? You were taught from a very young age to not experience it. So, fear, by the way, all fear, and if we lump all those together and just call it the one bracket of fear, all fear is what causes your physical pain. Every single physical pain you experience is the result of a fear. Now, I'm applying that to even things like diseases like cancers, heart issues, anything that can happen with the brain, lots of different things in your body. All of them are related to fear in some way. But just to give you an example of that, there was this lady in Dallas that I got some massages from, and she had these needle fingers, like just... She's this little lady, about 5 foot nothing, Chinese, and she did 3.5 hours of massage with me for 6 sessions at a time, 6 sessions I did in a row. And it was deep tissue massages. Anyone had some really decent deep tissue massage, right? So you know what that's like if somebody's really good at it. I just screamed and cried the entire time. And I was writhing around in agony, trying to get away from these needle fingers, and for the entire 3.5 hour sessions. The first 3.5 hour session, I came out, my entire body was black or blue. It took me nearly a week and a bit to recover where I could actually see my body as a flesh colour. And then I went again, because I'm a glutton for money. and did the same thing again and then again. And then I had a gap of nearly a year because I've become so frightened. I was even frightened to see her anymore. And then I did another 3 sessions when I returned to Dallas again and caught up with this lady again. And it was interesting on the very last session what happened. She was massaging away as usual, and I was screaming and crying as usual. And then all of a sudden, I had this realization enter me that it was my fear that was creating my pain. And it didn't enter me intellectually, because I've known about that kind of thought. You know, you've read about it in all sorts of journals and articles and magazines and so forth. But until you've actually experienced it emotionally, it doesn't become real. But right at that moment, it became real for me emotionally. And from that moment, it went from being this terrifying, painful experience. It was so bad just before then that I was about to ask her to stop, actually. We were about 2 hours into a session, the last session we had. And I was feeling so overwhelmed with the pain that I was about to ask her, look, I can't handle anymore. And then I had this realization and switched into this different state. And all of a sudden, she never changed anything she was doing. I still came out blue after the massage, but I felt a pleasurable experience from that moment on. So I stopped crying, I stopped screaming and trying to get off the table, And from then on, the whole thing, in fact, I felt these really strong tingling sensations running through my body the entire time that she continued the massage until the end. And that was just having the realization enter my soul, not my head, that the pain was all the result of fear. And that's something for you to consider with all of the pain that you experience. So how many of you are experiencing sort of quite a lot of pain in your body? Yeah? Okay, so if you think about it, if you allow yourself to just lay in bed in the morning before you get up and feel your body, you'll feel its aches and pains usually, right, before you get up. Every one of them is a result of a fear about an emotion that you're not allowing yourself to experience. So this morning, I was just laying there. I normally wake up around 4-ish or 4:30 every morning and lay there for a couple of hours. And this morning, I was just laying there and feeling I had some pains in my left leg and my left foot and in my muscle, in my calf. I had some pains in my hip. Had some pains across my chest, in my throat. And I was just laying there, just recognizing that all of them were the result of emotions I'm still suppressing. And if you do that, you will allow yourself to become more conscious of what's going on inside of yourself, emotionally. So what do the professionals say about fear? Let's have a look at that for a moment. So what we'll be doing today is just doing a bit of the theory work, shall we call it? And then what I was thinking of doing was asking if anyone would like to come up and we'll start and we'll talk about some of the practical things about your life, if you don't mind exposing your life to 80 or so people. Yeah. And we'll do a bit of the practical things about how we can follow fear down the rabbit hole, if you like, and find the truth. But what do the professionals say? Well, firstly, they say that fear is real in certain circumstances. So, for example, if you walk across the road and you get hit by a car, then they say, in that moment, obviously, just before you got hit by the car, if you noticed it coming, you would have experienced a state of fear. And they say that's normal. Right? Then the next state is where we do a lot of things in our life because we are afraid. And we could liken that to even walking across the road. We'll stop on the curb and we'll look left and look right, just like Mummy taught us, right? Or what's that? I can't remember exactly what Mummy taught me now. I had to look one of ways twice, wasn't it? That's right, left again, that's right. Anyway, we do that, and why do we do that? Because we are wanting to prevent a painful occurrence. So they also say that's normal. And you're going to ask, how can it not be? We'll talk about that.
Isn't that conditioned?
Sorry?
Isn't that a condition? Like if somebody's telling you to do something, isn't that like going into the mind as a condition and becoming a condition?
And a reality too. Yeah, we find that a lot of these things are actually not normal from God's perspective.
They're put onto us.
That's right. Yeah. And then the third state is the emotional fear that we feel. So that's where I'm afraid to walk across the road, like I have a phobia about walking across the road. Because the last time when I was 2 or 3 or 4, I almost got hit by a car. A lot of times we have fears not because anything happened to us, but because of what was projected at us. And my youngest son, Caleb, when he was 2 years of age, he used to play with redback spiders in our backyard. How many of you mothers would have gone out and had a bit of a fit about that? Yeah. Well, Caleb's mother, she ran out and yelled and screamed at him and, you know, went into this huge panic. And from that day onwards, Caleb's been scared of spiders. And he's still scared of spiders today. He hasn't released that emotion yet. Yeah. And nothing happened to him. None of the spiders even bit him. But he took on all of that fear from that event. The panic and terror of the mother got transmitted straight into his soul. Yeah. All right. Now, let's look at the first issue. If we get hit by a car walking across the road, then that's our law of attraction. Now, there must be something going on with that. Whether we looked or not, it's immaterial. If we're worried about walking across the road, then that is going to what? That is exposing a certain motion inside of us that we're now intellectually trying to skip over. And in the first state, all of the emotional stuff that's in us, the phobias and the fears that we have within us emotionally, all of those things don't need to exist within us. So from God's perspective, once you're at one with God, you will literally have no fear. At all. About anything. And you will be fully trusting in your law of attraction to bring you exactly what you need.
Has anyone achieved that?
Aside from the first century? No.
Is it achievable?
Yes, on earth it's achievable, yes.
Is it fear and knowing something's going to happen still the same?
And let's look at, there's a difference between foreknowledge and a fear that something is going to happen. They're two different things, really. The key is, like, a foreknowledge is often inspiration that we're receiving. So for example, our spirit guide, it's our spirit guardian, actually. But our spirit guardian has the role of actually protecting you, even from yourself, right? And from your law of attraction, in a lot of cases. So many times you will receive some kind of inspiration from a spirit that something might happen if you continue on a certain path. And you can that thing gives you the chance to change the path. But remember, they're also trying to help you emotionally. So they don't want you to just go and change the path now that you know the truth. What they want you to do is look at why you wanted to follow that original path in the first place. Right? So all forms of inspiration where we receive pictures or knowings, they come from outside of ourselves. They come from God through His spirits that are guarding us to us. That's totally different to the fears that we have inside of us. Totally different. And they're totally separate emotions as well.
Yeah, because I just thought knowing you're going to have a car accident...
Well, let's look at the issue of knowing you're going to have a car accident. Obviously, a spirit is telling you that you're going to have a car accident. Now, the question would then become, why am I going to have a car accident? What is happening in my law of attraction that would cause me to have this car accident? And this happened about 2 years ago. I think I told the group, many of you probably heard this already, but when the Apostle John was still alive on earth, he received a lot of inspiration about people's lives. And he had a person working for him, and he was told one night that the person working for him was going to have a very, very serious car accident and would be seriously hurt. And myself and John discussed it the next day as to what was actually going on. Like, should he tell the man that he was going to have this really terrible car accident? And we were talking about this principle of spirits guarding us, trying to let us know that something is going to happen. And the spirit guarding this man was trying to let him, this man, know that if he didn't change something, that this event would definitely occur. What actually happened was that the spirit, in fact, gave more information and said it was because of the way the man was keeping his car. There was something badly wrong with his car and the man was totally ignoring it. And it had to do with the brakes on this man's car. What happened? The man believed John and straight away just stopped driving the car, lifted it up under a pit, and all of the brake lining lines were all badly corroded and almost about to burst. And if he had been travelling at 110 km or something like that, with that, he would have had a very, very serious accident. So he straight away fixed that. And of course, there was no car accident. So all of those kind of things are more to do with inspiration. And they're all coming from spirits trying to prevent you from doing it. Now, what this man really needed to do is look more seriously at how the law of attraction was acting in his life. He needed to look why he was keeping his car in that kind of repair. Right? And a lot of that had to do more with issues of unworthiness and emotions such as those, which he wasn't looking at, and he still isn't looking at, actually. Yeah. So on one hand, an accident was prevented in that instant. But on the other hand, because he hasn't changed the way that he deals with his life, there's a very high likelihood that another event will occur until he deals with the emotion that was going to create that event.
Because I've had a number of those over a period of years.
Mm.
And I mean, some of it wasn't like a car accident. It was dealing with two with past life.
Yeah. Yeah. So the key is to...
just the windscreen.
So the key is to look into it emotionally, what's causing every event emotionally. Everything that happens to you, every single thing that happens to you is something to do with an emotion. We were driving here today and we were just before Gympie on the way through, and this car, this guy in a Mercedes, it was a lady actually, a Mercedes, came up behind me and come right up. You know how they come right up and almost touch
the windscreen.
Yeah. Touch the back of your car, and we were doing 100 k's, and she was just standing, would have been half a car length behind my car. And I was going to myself, the first instance of the response is, what would be yours? I wish that person would get off my tail, right? Yeah. But that's the first response. But you created it. So what I had to do then is go into it emotionally. So, all right, I'm feeling, what am I feeling? I'm feeling, pressured and pushed into doing something that I don't really want to do. Yeah. So I had to then feel about what I was doing to create that. And then I was feeling also a feeling of my life being threatened. That's been coming up for me a lot lately with regard to identity issues and me not processing those particular issues, about fears about my life at some point being threatened the more and more people know who I'm claiming to be. Mm-hmm. And so I've had to look at a lot more seriously at that, just from that little incident of the lady coming right up behind me in the car. And I think it was last week in Brisbane I talked to... group in Brisbane about another law of attraction of when I was in a plane coming home as well. But that's where I was the only person that wasn't served on the plane, a meal. Now, have any of you heard this story?
No.
A few have. For those who haven't, this is for you. We were coming home from overseas. It was an overseas trip, and I'm usually very careful, which has to do with the fear as well, obviously, about booking my right meals, because I'm vegetarian or vegan. So I'm vegan, so usually I only have a fruit platter or something vegan on the plane. So I usually book it in advance. And I booked it in advance for all of my trips overseas. But this particular one trip, everyone gets served and I don't get served. And it's so tempting at that point to put up your hand and say, why am I, what's happened to my meal, right? And instead of doing that, what I chose to do was to actually stay in the emotion of what it felt like to not be served and everybody else was. Right? And I decided to stay in that emotion because I felt that the instant I connected to that emotion, I would actually get served without having to say anything.
Yes.
And that's exactly what happened.
Yes.
To do with being overlooked, not cared for, forgotten, all of those kind of things. Just a little event like that. Right?
So does that mean it'll never happen again?
If the emotion is completely released, that will never happen again. All right. If the emotion, often what we do is we don't completely release the emotion. So we connect to a bit of it, and I connected to it for about 15 minutes. I had a bit of a cry and whatever in the plane. That's about all I thought I could do on the plane in front of everyone. So, and it changed, my law of attraction changed. But obviously, if I haven't dealt with that emotion completely, then another event will be created to help bring up that emotion again and again. So what I've been trying to do lately is focus on the law of attraction and how it's accessing everything. And how every single fear that I still feel is my pathway home. All right. Now, And in another session that we've had, when I talked about the law of attraction and the denial of the soul, I talked about the different things that we do to actually suppress our emotions. And I've listed them, in the outline that I've given you. What we do when we fear, it's in that section there. And I don't think we'll go through it in a practical way later as to what's actually happening when people come up. Anybody hasn't got any? We've still got some left. So they can be passed around. Yeah. We'll go through them in a practical way later. All right? So we won't discuss them very much now. But the key thing to understand is that fear is the result of not accepting divine truth. Now that just went over the top of most of you, so I'm going to say it again. Fear is the result of not accepting God's truth.
How many people even know what that is?
What God's truth is?
Yeah.
Well, that's what we're trying to find out, what God's truth is. And we'll talk about, that's what we're talking about tomorrow. Some of the qualities of divine truth. So tomorrow's session is about the qualities of divine truth. How you can recognise God's truth, right, and know what God's truth is. Today we're talking about the fear that we hold that prevents us from recognising truth. Right? And fear is always the result of not accepting in our heart God's truth. Who's afraid of dying? To be honest. Who'd be happy, who'd be okay with dying? Like, let me put it a different way. Who's got children? How many of you got children? How many of you wouldn't cry at their funeral if they died today? What does that mean?
We don't want to.
You obviously have some fears still associated and some emotions still associated with a belief that's false, right? Because if you fully believe the truth, you wouldn't even feel like crying at their funeral. Can you understand that?
Yes. So where does the grieving come in then?
Grieving is all the result of what we feel. There's some emotions within us of what that we're starting to release, connected to our childhood and what we feel we're going to miss out on, and you know, the feeling and the belief that we have that now we can't contact our child, or that our child's life's been damaged forever, or there's lots of
grieving.
And if the emotion is in you, then it is totally necessary to grieve. So I'm not saying don't grieve. What I'm saying is, if I'm grieving, then it's because I'm not accepting yet emotionally a divine truth.
Well,
no, see, it's not about an intellectual decision to not do something or do something.
I was trying to say.
Be careful. When you hear me say something about what God's truth is, don't then assume that you need to be at that place right now. And that's a common mistake. See, if you try to jump to that location without experiencing all of the emotion in between, remember we've discussed that before, right? You can't do that. So if you are grieving, you need to let yourself grieve. But understand one thing, and that is that because you're grieving, it means that you haven't yet accepted one of God's truths, or maybe many, in your heart. And the grief is the proof of that. And now, I'm not condemning grieving, because I'm saying to you, grieving is the healing emotion. Without grief, you're not going to heal at all. You're not going to ever become to a place of being without fear and being totally in love if you don't grieve. But understand that I'm grieving because there's a truth I am not yet able to feel. Once I feel it, there'll be no more grief. Right? So I've experienced this when my best friend John died, he was murdered, and I didn't grieve because I didn't have any feelings of grief about it left. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
To me, he's still alive. I can talk to him still. I feel him with me still. We have probably more contact now than we ever had. So to me, like, what's the point of even crying? There was no emotion in me at that moment. If there is an emotion, then it's just there's a truth that you're not accepting. And understand that you can't jump to that truth without experiencing the emotion first. So you do need to experience the emotion of grief if that is there. And once you experience the emotion of grief fully, you will never ever grieve again.
What if it's an emotion of joy?
Same. All emotions pass through you. So with all emotions, it's just a matter of experiencing them until they're finished.
I mean, if someone, I went with my first funeral at 20,
yeah.
It was my grandfather's, and I actually felt joy.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not happy that he died, I was happy for him.
Yeah, that's great.
And I noticed everyone else around me was really sad.
Yeah.
And I thought I felt strange because of the reflection of what was going on around me.
Yeah.
So
you felt almost condemned by everyone else's
opinions. You're not supposed to feel joy. So there's a conditioning also that
it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Around.
That's right.
But I specifically remember the feeling of joy.
Yeah, and that's great.
It's true.
Yeah. When you'll find it in every experience, when you're in a condition of truth, there's always joy associated with it.
Yeah.
It's when you're in a condition of fear that there's usually pain or grief or other types of emotions associated with it. But you can't jump from one location to the other. So, for instance, let's say now that was your child who died. How would you feel now?
Yeah, probably might be feeling some fear.
Yeah. And some grief.
Some grief around hopes and dreams.
Exactly. Lost, yeah. So it's all about your own hopes and dreams
yeah, yeah.
that you feel you've lost in your childhood.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
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 Yeah. Can you see the link there?
Yeah.
Yeah. So often fear is the result of our wanting to suppress the underlying emotion. So that's when we go into fear. Right? That's the time we go into fear. We want to suppress, deny, control it, experience something else instead of it, and all of those different ways that we use to deny it. Yeah? And to keep it under wraps.
I don't know whether this is on topic, but I want to ask it anyway. Is it our fears and our blocked emotions that keep us in this physical reality, and that if we progress through our fears and our emotions, we'll then become, for want of a better way of putting it, enlightened and disappear in the spirit or die?
It's not your fears that keep you in this reality. This reality was a reality created by God for you to incarnate. Remember the purpose of your incarnation?
Okay.
Was to become an individual. Remember that?
Yeah.
That was we discussed that in the very first stuff that we did.
Okay.
So the purpose of coming into a physical form is so that we can learn a lot of the lessons about what it means to be an individual. You can be in a totally enlightened state right here in the physical form. So this belief that when you become enlightened you leave the physical is in fact a fallacy. It doesn't make any sense from God's perspective either when you think about it, does it? God created the physical. Why would he create something that...
For it to go.
For it to go. Like, of course he wouldn't do that. You can stay in the physical as long as you wish or desire, even in, if we can call it, an enlightened state. Right? So that's not the issue. The issue is how you live in this state. Do you live in fear in this state, or are you living in love in this state? That's the issue. Does that answer?
Yeah, that's a fear. Thank you.
So this belief that we have that when we become enlightened we will no longer be attracted to the physical, right, is just another one of those beliefs about the pain we experience in the physical and wanting to get away from that pain. The truth is that you can experience the physical without any pain whatsoever. That's the truth. That's God's truth. That's what he created. So your father created this environment where you can be in no pain, always in pleasure, and always in desire, and always in passion, and always in longing, and never experiencing anything else, and still stay in the physical state.
What's the connection between fear and the ego, as in the way it's normally expressed?
Well, you could say really that fear is the result of suppression of underlying emotion. And when you think about it, ego is the same thing in a lot of ways, isn't it? Why do we create this false persona, or let's call it the ego? It's because we're trying to suppress underlying emotions that we don't want to admit to ourselves that we actually have. Do you remember in the channeling from the January discussions, when Natalie did the channeling of Lucinda? She said when she went from the sixth sphere to the third sphere, she had to become more real emotionally. Remember she used that term? And that's what it means. To become more real emotionally means to start looking at things in sincerity, looking at everything sincerely inside of yourself. What's really inside of me? Not what I hope is inside of me, or what I think is inside of me, or I imagine is inside of me, or I want everyone else to see is inside of me. None of that. But rather, what is really inside of me. And then to be totally open and real about that. And that's what all of us are going to need to do if we want to become at one with God. To get real about all of that. What's really there. Fear is the same result in the end as ego, in that they're both suppressing the real self. Yeah. So you can think of it. Let's say these are the group of emotions that we have. And we like the pleasurable ones mostly, right? So we're really talking about the painful emotions that we have here, right? So we've got this, at this moment, a group of painful emotions inside of us that are preventing our bliss. So what do we do with that? We have two choices, really. We can either access them and experience them, or we can make out that we don't have them. What might most of us choose to do? We make out we don't have them. Right? So what we do is we place a layer of suppression on them. Right? So we suppress them, we keep them down, we don't want to experience them. And remember, emotions are energy in motion. They are always experiences. Right? So people ask, I say to someone, oh, you've got a lot of grief inside of you. Yes, I know I do, they say. And I'm saying, so why aren't you crying? Right? And the answer is because... Well, because they're not experiencing their emotion. The emotion is just frozen in there, right? Not being experienced. So many of us are so used to not experiencing our emotion. All right? And instead of experiencing it, what are we doing? We're locking it down and then we make out we don't have it. Or we say it wasn't that bad anyway. Or we say we use all these different tools of denial. What are the ones I've got written down there? We deny it, doesn't really happening, never really happened. I just do something else when it happens. I only feel afraid when I'm around you, or I only feel the emotion when I'm around you, so I stay away from you. I don't remember what happened. Right? I'm afraid sometimes when it's not so bad, you know. And we go down these roads of all this intellectual denial, and it all comes from our desire, one desire only, the desire to suppress. There is a desire coming from our soul, is the desire to not experience this pain. And if we want to come to do this with our emotions, right, we're going to need to come to embrace our emotions. We're going to need to come to experience everything. Everything, even the painful ones.
AJ, what if you do it, if you got yourself to the point where you've suppressed it so much you don't even know that you've got the
pain? A few weeks ago you were in that point.
Oh, I was.
And yet but now, look what's happened.
And until you told me that you need to experience some grief, I had no clue.
Yep.
I asked for a trigger and...
And you got one.
Got it in spades.
Okay. And but, now but, you're in your grief, aren't you?
Oh, well, truly.
Yeah.
But before that, I had... I had no idea that it was even there.
Yeah. And a lot of times that's where we're at, and that's why often we do need external help. So this is why almost everyone in the universe at some point generally has received help from somebody else to get into a state of awakening to our emotions. The key is when you ask for the help, just like you did, you got it straight away, and the trigger happened straight away, and you're in your emotion pretty much soon after that, weren't you? So the triggers all happen just automatically once you set your intention, and we'll talk about practical things we can do with our fear. Once we set our intention, everything changes around us from that point. Yeah. So a few weeks ago, you were feeling locked up. You could feel all the grief across your chest. You were having asthma, weren't you? And and all those kind of feelings, all as a result of that grief shutting you down, but not experiencing the emotion. All it required was somebody to just say, all I did was put my hand on Justin's chest like that and just said, Justin, you got a lot of grief in there and you just need to let yourself cry. That's all I said. The next few days, he got some big triggers. Biggest triggers he's ever had in his life, probably. And straight away into the grief. Yeah, because he's allowing it to flow. Still flowing?
Yeah.
That's good. It'll, when it finishes, let it finish naturally. It'll finish. So when we go to the desire to suppress, that's when we start exercising, getting into fear. And fear is the thing that keeps everything locked down underneath it. Because we don't want to feel these things, these painful emotions. That's the main reason why we get into that state. All right, so is there any questions so far about what we've discussed? What we want to do a bit later is put a lot of this into some practice if I can have some guinea pigs. I've got a volunteer on the back, so that's good. At least one volunteer. That's good. All right. Well, let's firstly look at the relationship between truth and error. A lot of things in our lives are like the two opposite extremes happen to be links to each other. And this is, you'll find this all the way through your existence. For example, let's say we have a scale here, sliding scale, right? And here is the position of truth. Well, the opposite end of that is the position of fear. Remember, the truth is, we're talking about God's truth here, not your truth, right? And we talk about the difference between personal truth and divine truth, and we do that a lot tomorrow. But it's important to understand that we're talking about God's truth here, not your own, right? In the New Age stuff, it's always your truth, stay in your truth. If you stay in your truth, you will never become at one with God, right? Because God's truth is infinite. If you want to just hold on to your truth, you're never going to grow. Right. Fear is false expectations or emotions appearing real. Right. So in other words, what we believe to be true, but is in reality error. That's fear. Right. So how many of you right now, and be honest with yourself and just let yourself feel, how many of you right now believe that crying, if you cry in front of someone else, you'll be judged? That's quite a strong emotion, isn't it? Like, yeah. And how many times are you judged? All the time, I find. Right? So it happens to be a truth of your reality, doesn't it? Right? And the reason why is because it's a false expectation appearing real to us. It's happened from the moment we were born, right, till now. So why don't we think it's going to... Of course we're going to think it's going to continue to happen. Aren't we? There's also another scale. Let's call this one the pleasure. And the opposite of pleasure?
Pain.
Pain scale. Okay. Now, the pleasure-pain scale is interesting because God has created the universe in such a way that the more you resist truth, the more painful your life becomes. And sooner or later, your pain will get so great that it overcomes your fear or your resistance to truth. So remember, your fear is your resistance to truth, right? And sooner or later, the pain will get greater than your fear, And when that happens, then you'll deal with the emotion.
Can you say it again, please?
Well, let's put it in a practical situation. Let's say on a fear scale we're a 7. So in other words, we're living most of our life, we have a bit of our life where we're feeling quite relaxed and happy and free, but most of our life we're living in a place of constraint because of the fears that we have. Right? So, you know, we might fear what might happen to our children, we might fear what might happen to our husband, we might fear what's happening in our job, you know, and a lot of those different things. But we have moments in our life where we feel completely happy. What's going to happen is that our pain in our life is going to have to exceed, maybe get to an 8, right, in terms of a level. It's going to have to exceed our fear before we'll start releasing or feeling the emotions of the pain. Because if our fear is greater, it shuts down the emotional experience, so we can't release the pain. You follow me?
Is it funny to the sense, I suppose, the more pain you're feeling in between getting up to that 8, your mind would tell you that it's actually, see, it's true, I've got a reason to fear this.
Oftentimes that's what happens, the opposite. And our fear grows, and so therefore our pain is going to have to increase. Yeah. In the spirit world, when you meet lots of spirits in the spirit world, you'll find that in the hells of the spirit world, the majority of them, the majority of spirits there are not spirits who have been evil on earth. They're not spirits who, like, they are in the depths of the hells generally, but they're mostly, the people in the first sphere, mostly are people who are not willing to let go of their fears. Right? And so what often happens is you go to speak with them, and even just the act of somebody showing interest in them, they're afraid. How many of you, when you first met me, asked yourself the question, what's he got up his sleeve? Why is he doing this? How many of you asked yourself that? Right? A lot more than what we did. Not being honest. Almost everybody asks that. The reason why is that how many times has it been happened that you've been given something for free without there being some kind of string attached? How many times did that happen? Are you suspicious of something that's free? Yeah? Well, imagine if you passed over in the spirit world and somebody came to show you some personal interest. What would you then feel? You'd feel worried, wouldn't you? Can you trust this person? Why are they doing this? And they're telling you, oh, it's because I love you. No, something else is going on. People don't understand that love is the greatest motivator in the universe, right? But something else has to be going on. There must be something. And of course, in the spirit world, there's no money, so there's got to be something else. And it becomes very confusing, right, for many spirits who have passed. And so many of them don't get assistance because they don't want it. They reject the assistance given to them. And when you think about it, it's the same on earth with us many times, isn't it? How many times have you been presented with a person or a place or a thing that really didn't appear to be everything was fine with it? And you didn't take it because you became suspicious. Yeah. That happens a lot, doesn't it? So fear prevents us. And so what happens is, we desire to feel pleasure, but the conundrum is, because we also at the same moment desire to suppress our pain, we then have to allow our pain gets greater and greater and greater throughout our lives until our pain exceeds our fear. And then at that moment, we start dealing. How many of you began looking at spiritual things or began looking at emotional things because of pain? I know I did.
Is that where depression kicks in? Is that like a healing crisis? Or is that a suppression?
Depression is the complete suppression of emotion, the emotional experience. What happens is that, remember we went through the suppression. So here we have the painful emotion, right? Then what we do is we suppress the painful emotion, right? That causes us to get into a state of fear, which, by the way, is also a state many times of anger. Right? Then we suppress that because we're not allowed to feel angry, are we? And particularly women, you find, have a lot more problems with anger than men. Why is that? because most women have had violent anger projected at them and they find it very unpleasant, so they then feel, then judge it, that they can't have it for themselves. You follow me? Right? So then they suppress that, which gets you into the state of being depressed. Right? So many people who experience depression firstly need to experience some rage, then need to experience some deeper emotions of the pain of what was underneath that, right? But most, this is why there's what, four times as much depression in women than men? Because what do men do when they get into this state?
Beat their wife.
Yeah, they dump it all on somebody else, right? Generally, that's what happens in that. Isn't when a man gets into that state, generally they get angry at everyone else around them, right? But many women, when they're in that state, don't want to get angry at everyone around them. Or if they got angry with their man, they'd get a bop in the nose and they're afraid of additional pain. And so what they do is go into the state of complete suppression of every emotion, which is the state of depression. Don't confuse that, though, with manic depression, because they are totally different states. Does everyone want to know what the difference is?
Yes.
All right. Depression is the state that I've just described, where there's no external influence occurring on you aside from your own desire to completely suppress all of your own emotion. You follow me? Mm-hmm. That's the state of depression. Manic depression, where you have cycles of highs and lows, is a state influenced by spirits. What happens with the manic depression is that you get it. What will happen is that you'll get into a state of depression initially. The state of depression is a very powerless state. And if the person has some kind of longing to be powerful within them, and they have some kind of mediumistic skills, and by the way, nowadays, a good half of the world's population is mediumistic in a lot of ways, or even more. All of you, in fact, are mediumistic naturally, but we often suppress that. So if we're particularly mediumistic, what will happen when we're in this state of powerlessness is we will desire power. And when we desire power, we don't often desire it from other people, because most of the time other people in that state, due to the law of attraction, won't give it to us anyway. So what we do is we start attracting spirits who are also feeling powerless, who want to feel power. And four or five or six or ten of them will all band together. And what they will do is feed you with their energy, keeping you in a state of a high until you exhaust your own self. So what happens is you're in the state of a high, and in that state, this is why many people like to have lots of sexual activity generally. Often they get drinking heavily, often they're doing other things, right? Which are all heavily spirit influenced. So they're in this state of a high. That state of a high will remain until the person's physiology is so exhausted that the spirits can no longer maintain a connection with them. And at that point, the spirits no longer being able to maintain the connection, everything drops out, and all of a sudden they go wham back into this deep depression. Often in the space of an hour.
AJ, what are the spirits getting out of this experience? Why are they doing it?
Most spirits are doing it because they are yet to actually resolve their emotions about staying in the spirit world. And many of them still want to experience the things they were experiencing on Earth. So for example, if you're a drunkard, for example, and you pass into the spirit world, obviously there's no drink there. So what they often do is they go into a state of trying to get the feeling of being drunk from a person on Earth. The way they do that is they attach to a person on Earth who's open to their attachment, and they cause them to drink even more. They cause them to drink until the point that they are standing up, they're not even conscious of what they're doing, then they're still drinking. Right? And they will keep that connection until that connection drops out because of the person being in such an oblivious state that they have to sleep or rest. And the same applies to manic depression. So the two, so depression is a suppression of everything. Manic depression is me wanting to suppress my emotions, but also wanting to retain a feeling of powerfulness, which will attract spirits who also are in that same state where they feel weak and want to get to a state of powerfulness. You follow me?
Mm-hmm. And Jane, what can be done for these people? Because there's a lot of people in that state. And...
yeah, lots can be done for them, actually. Mm-hmm. And we're probably getting off topic onto another topic there. But lots can be done for them, and maybe at another session we can talk about that. But there's so much to be done, because a lot of it's about the spirit influence. So, and when there's a lot of spirit influence, there's just so much that you can do to help a person. The same applies to schizophrenia, by the way. There's so much you can do to help those illnesses. Not medication. I'm not decrying medication, because often the person needs medication to disconnect from the spirits, right? But you need to educate the person about what they're doing inside of themselves emotionally. That's the key thing. Uh-huh. And we can talk about that more in a later topic.
But they wouldn't have a clue, would they, if they're doing that?
Many do have a clue.
Do they?
Yeah, I've talked to many people who have got manic depression or schizophrenia, and they know they're hearing voices all the time, they're talking to different entities all the time. They know what they're doing, they know they're getting highs, they know they're getting inclinations from spirits for them to do different things. They just feel good in a powerful state when they do it. Mm-hmm. Right? So, yeah, there's this... On the recent trip, I talked to a lady about that. She's manic depressive, and yeah. But let's go back on topic. It is an interesting topic, though. We could talk further about it. So the answer to that question about depression, the suppression of all emotion. Yeah.
So, AJ, when we're getting that layer of suppression, it's usually like our muscles and stuff, they start tensing, and that's oftentimes why we're feeling pain.
Yep.
But, like, physically, what else?
We'll talk about the practical things in a minute.
Okay.
All right? And I just want to help you understand a little bit more of the theory first, and then we'll talk about the practical things of what actually is happening inside of our body and all of those kind of things. Yeah. Yep. There's one other scale I'd like to mention too, by the way. Apathy, that is, by the way.
There's a question here.
Sorry?
Sorry, I just wanted to know where stress fitted in there. Is that type of fear?
Sorry, what?
Where stress fits.
Stress is certainly all fear related.
So, like fear of burnout.
Well, it depends on what's going on inside. And perhaps where we do some practical stuff, you'll see that really clearly. But all stress is fear-related. Right? How many of you feel stressed after work every day? Most, you know. How many of you need a drink after work? That's a good indication. Let's look at this scale. This scale is very important too, the desire scale. There's a whole section that I do... a whole discussion on the law of desire, which is actually a law of the universe. God's created desire because that's the way everything, God does everything. Everything is based upon desire, his desire or her desire. The same applies to yourself. When you get out of desire, you start moving towards a place of apathy, where you sort of don't want to feel anything. You don't, and this is a place also of suppression, isn't it? Right? So can you see how all of these things are all the things that once we're at one with God we'll be experiencing all the time, and all of these things are the things we experience a lot in the day-to-day life, aren't they? And you can see that as we deal with things in truth, all of these things will start reducing from the place of this point back to the place where God created them to be. So that's how God made it for you. You follow me? Mm-hmm.
But this side is part of the play, though, is it?
And this has all begun from one emotion. And where all of this came from was from, and remember I've said this before, right? From the emotion of being self-reliant. So every all of these things, fear, pain, apathy, and all of these other things that you'll experience that are not a part of bliss, are all coming from the point where we're desiring self-reliance and we don't want to be reliant on God. All right? So that's where they all came from in the beginning. But most of us, and like I said before too, the most difficult emotion you will ever, ever deal with in your life is going to be the emotion of self-reliance, believe it or not, where you want to, where you have to give it up. And it's so hard to give it up because it will confront every single aspect of your life. All right, so you can see that if our...
Sorry. Just with the self-reliance and the correct God-reliance.
Yep.
My word is right. What's the difference of being like a leaf in a wind and relying fully on being guided and directed by the Creator and actually being responsible for... self-responsible for direction in your life?
Yeah, good question. Does God want you to do anything?
He would like you to love him.
If you think back to my question again. Does God want you to do anything? Well, there's only one thing God wants.
Love.
Right? God doesn't even want your love.
Choose to love.
He wants to give you
choose
to love.
No.
Does he want me to follow my own desire?
Yeah. That's the only thing God wants. God wants you to follow your desire. You follow me? It's the only thing God wants. If your desire is to go and murder someone, God's happy with you making that choice. Is that confronting? Well, if God wasn't happy with you making that choice, he would have made a law that wouldn't allow you to make that choice. So he must be happy with you making that choice. Why is he happy with you making that choice? Because he knows that all of his laws will deal with you.
I like that.
Doesn't he? Like, his system's perfect, right? His system's absolutely perfect. All of his laws will deal with whatever you choose to do. Whether they are opposite to love or whether they're loving. That will automatically happen, right? So God is okay with you choosing to murder, if that's what you desire to do. Because all of her laws automatically will bring into effect the instant you make the decision, even. And there will automatically be things happening to your soul that will automatically bring you to a point of correction. And all of those things will begin from the instant you even think about doing it.
Doesn't that almost mean, and this is from my limited understanding,
yep.
me, that God's passive observer of our desires?
No.
Good. Well, tell me why. Because it seems like to me that in my desire,
yep.
whatever that might be, that I'm empowered by that, and so God's there watching, but not getting involved.
There's a difference between not getting involved and being passive, isn't there? like passive almost, a lot of times when we think of the word passive, like God being passive, like God is apathetic about what we do. That's not the case. God is not apathetic about anything. Remember, apathy is this end of the scale? What's the other end of the scale? God is in the desire place, not in an apathetic
I'm
place.
I'm not sure I meant apathy by passive.
Okay, what do you mean?
I think that God's not participating in our desire.
Whoa, definitely not. He is participating in our desire. But it requires our desire to activate his participation. Do you follow me? See, if you don't have a desire for God to participate, God will not participate. If you exercise a desire for God to participate, then God will automatically participate. It all depends on your desire. God is responding to your desire, to your free will. And that includes your free will to have God be a part of your life. That it, he gave you that gift as well. You can make that choice. Right? So it's very important you understand that. God has a strong, passionate desire to be a part of your life. And there's a whole discussion I have on having a passion for God, where I talk about God's passion for you. Right? Don't confuse that with God not being involved in your life right now. God's not involved in your life right now. If you feel that, then it's because of your soul desire not being activated to have that occur.
Mm-hmm.
The instant you want God to be involved in your life from your heart mm-hmm. is the instant that God involves himself in your life. But clarification, from your heart, not from your
mind.
Yeah.
And James, so is I'm just getting back to God wants us to follow our desires, so like Hitler in the Holocaust, he has no judgment about that because the law of attraction deal with Hitler's actions.
God doesn't have judgment about anything because God has already put laws into place that automatically look after everything. So if there's a law looking after everything, automatically you don't need to judge anything, do you? It's not like God's up there saying, right, yeah, I saw Hitler do that. Yeah, I saw him do that. If he did that with everyone, imagine what his life would be like. Right? Imagine trying to keep track of billions and billions and billions of children and every single little tiny thing they've done to break a law or not. Right? Imagine that. So, of course, God doesn't do that. So he doesn't judge what's going on. God's laws automatically have placed the... they do all the things that need to happen to correct the situation. God's laws automatically do that. God created those laws. They automatically respond to every single thing happening in your soul. So let's look at a person like Hitler. A person like Hitler who chooses to, through his own soul damage, to actually deny his own soul damage, go into a state of fear and then create soul damage in billions or millions of other people, or billions in his case, right, of other people, will have automatic penalties placed upon his soul due to the laws that God has created. So God doesn't need to judge him. The laws are automatically having their response. So the truth is that Hitler is in the depths of the hells, but only because of his own desire. You follow me? He followed his desire in a negative in an anti-love format, and of course that leads you deeper and deeper and deeper into darkness. But God doesn't judge that. God allows him to do that. Now, of course, it wasn't just Hitler that did this, right? There had to be millions of people on earth who allowed him to do it, you know? And not just in Germany, I mean in the West as well, you know? All of the different decisions, policies that they made, political decisions that they made towards Germany, right from First World War and even before that, all had an effect on the creation of this man.
Yes.
Right? And they will all be attributed through the laws of God back to their beginnings. Right? So God has and wants you to operate in this state of desire. If you operate in a state of desire that is anti-love, if you like, or the opposite to love, or the opposite to truth, then you will automatically have drawn to yourself penalties on your soul that will cause you to get into a state of correction at some point in the future. Right? That's what pain's all about. So Hitler at the moment is in extreme pain. Right?
Would Hitler be having to actually feel and those around it, feel every suffering of every soul damage that's actually occurred while he's in?
Can you imagine that? It's almost unimaginable. Yeah. This is why a really good message to read in the pageant messages is one from Nero, if you haven't read that yet. I don't remember what book it's in. Is it book two, is it? Yeah, I don't know. There's four. I've got them all in the CDs, and by the way, we've got about 20 or 30 of those CDs left here if anybody wants them, if you haven't got copies. But they're in the pageant messages. There's a writing about Nero, and Nero was a Hitler-like person when he was on Earth. Of course, he didn't have the power to do as much damage because it was more localised, but he was the head of the Roman empire, so obviously lots of damage. And he tries to describe in one of the messages the pain that he went through coming out of that place. Right? And it's unimaginable. So, yeah, if you think that if you just kill one person, you're going to have to experience the emotional damages that have occurred to everything around, all of the people around that person, from God's perspective, all the laws are all created so that all of those damages are now placed upon your own soul. So everything that that person experienced while they were dying, you will experience. That's the law of compensation. That's just one person.
I'm just about hit one. I just thought maybe, like, a lot of us still have a lot of fear and pain around people.
Yeah.
And that is an issue for our soul as well.
Because
I think Hitler was in a lot of fear himself, and so compassion and actually assistance for Hitler would, I think, shift an amazing energy on our planet.
Well, almost the entire Israeli state at the moment is still in that state of pain, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you can see all of its actions right across the board are all to do with just responding to that state of something that happened like years and years ago, generations ago in many cases, right? Yeah. So can I just get back and say a bit more about that too? Is that our fear about things like that occurring is what actually draws them into occurring. Because we're actually avoiding the emotion that we're trying to suppress by that fear. And we'll talk more about the fear and how it's operating in a sec.
Just taking a little bit off that, the afraid of fear, if we eat meat, do we incur fear around the meat?
Yes. Before it dies, yes. And in all of the animal kingdom, yes. So just you eating meat causes fear in animals, yes. And fear in animals then creates, you could say, anger-based reactions in animals, right? All of them are the result of our soul condition. Yeah, everything.
But what about the animals that take on the soul contract to, say, be farmed organically for the purpose of providing food for us?
Now you're going all New Age, and it's not true.
No?
No, there is no such thing as an animal taking on a contract, because animals don't have souls. They have a spirit body and a physical body. They reflect the condition of our soul. Right? And because they reflect the condition of our soul, they are going to respond completely to what our soul is feeling. Right? And there is no such thing as animals coming here to take on a contract to be eaten.
Does that mean we don't have to take on the suffering of the animal being murdered?
If you murder the animal, yes.
No, but if you eat it, because it had to have been murdered, so eat it.
Yes, if you eat the animal, yes.
Okay.
Because you're creating its murder, are you not?
Mm.
Are you not?
Yes.
Like, just because you didn't slit its throat, does that mean... This is.
You're just helping to dispose of the body.
Yeah. Good justification. And I'll talk about this subject another time. But it's a very important subject too, about how your emotions create everything that's happening around you, right? Including the response of animals and creatures around you as well, right? That's enough now, you reckon?
The desire, apathy thing is actually creating fear for me.
Yeah, go on.
Because I'm a very good creator, you know, and I've only got to really think about something and it happens, doesn't it? But I create so much that it's too much for me. Then I have to get into apathy and say, well, you take care of it. I don't have to do it now. You know.
So can you see what emotions are being triggered?
No.
Can anyone else see what emotions are being triggered?
Overwhelming.
Mm. Well, no, you're being overwhelmed by good things happening to you. So what's that emotion?
Unworthiness.
See, you just intellectualised out of it.
Well, I'm trying to think if I am being overwhelmed by what's happening to me.
Why would you be afraid to be a creator and to be continuously creating?
Because I don't quite know how to handle it all when I get it and it gets too much.
And why don't you know how to handle it all? Why does it get too much for you? Because you're not allowing the emotional experience of it. Because if you allowed the emotional experience of it, it would never get too much for you.
I'm talking about creating physical things.
I'm talking about creating anything too. I'm talking about the same thing as you are. You just don't think I am.
So does that mean that if I'm now saying, oh, I've created all this, now I want to move on from that and create something else, I'm now to the point where I'm saying, well, maybe I'm not so good at this creation. Maybe I'm just... maybe I would just say, well, look, I don't know what's ahead, you just sort it out, you know?
Well, if you're creating a lot of things that you later on are regretful of...
I'm not regretful.
Are they tying you down?
They are tying me down.
So then you are regretful. Can you see what we do?
Sorry, I created it. But I would like somebody else to take the money
out. Well, so you're not really creating what your soul truly desires.
What my soul desires.
No, it's what you thought your soul desired.
Okay. So how
because if your soul truly desired it, and it would desire it forever, pretty much, wouldn't it? And if it didn't desire it, wouldn't it just not worry about giving it up either? So if you're worried about giving things up, if you're having the feeling of I'm being weighed down by my creation.
I'm trying to give them up.
There's no such thing as trying. You know that, surely.
No, I am. I'm trying to sell it.
I'm
even asking
it
to find someone.
I reckon we need to have you come sit up here. Well, may as well while we're at it. What was your name again?
Carol.
Come and sit down with me. You're okay with this?
Yes, I'm okay with this. I'm like celibate, actually.
All right.
I'm starting to feel fear for Carolyn.
Who's feeling fear for Carol? Who fears for Carol? Poor Carol. They all think I'm an ogre. That's not true.
I'm happy to solve it.
Yeah. So first thing you said.
Yes.
Was you've created all these beautiful things. You thought they were beautiful at the time.
Oh, I still think they're beautiful.
Yeah. But they're now weighing you down.
Yes.
Can you explain a little bit about the situation?
I've created a retreat centre.
Yep.
Which is really lovely. And I don't quite know how I created it. But anyway, I did. I wouldn't like to do it again.
It's called Heaven in the Hills, by the way.
Yes. And I'm sitting here next to Jesus. It brings a lot of pleasure to a lot of people, but it is more than I can cope with. And
can you explain a little bit what's happening to you personally?
Yes, well, I now have breast cancer and I have to go and have a mastectomy in a week's time, but and I'm feeling okay about that, really. But now I've had the meltdown. I think I've tried to find the emotion behind all this, that you know, yes, it was a lot of aloneness and doing it on my own, and a lot of financial debt. I started it with $42,000, you know, so it's now sort of a million or so past that in debt, and it's quite a lot to deal with. So, whereas everybody's very happy about coming there and they all enjoy themselves, it's killing me. So I feel I've created it, and now it's like I liken it to a child who's about 15 and still wants to be picked up. You know, I'm saying you're too heavy. I can't pick you up now. And I'm even saying to my property, look, I'm over trying to find a buyer for you. You really need to attract one yourself now.
Yeah. You know? So you could say at the moment you're in a place of fair bit of pain.
I might be next week.
And first thing with pain, and this is the first thing for you too, we have to admit it. Now,
yes.
Having breast cancer is a painful thing, isn't it?
Well, it isn't yet, but it will be when.
Well, it is a painful thing, even from an emotional point.
Yeah, it's painful to think I've got something wrong with me and to think that I've created that.
You've created
well.
That, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Now, let's look at the truth of breast cancer. Breast cancer comes from over-nurturing.
Yes.
Over-nurturing. Do you understand what I mean by that?
Yeah.
Right. This happens a lot with women in particular, because they're used to nurturing, used to like having children, and that causes you to want to nurture, right? And so what happens is we start over-nurturing. Now, what causes us to do that to the point of extreme pain? What's the truth? What emotion?
We want nurturing. We want to be nurtured.
Yeah, that's a bit intellectual. Let's look at it more emotional. What causes me to desire to over-nurture you? So let's say I wanted to look after you and I want to do everything possible for you.
You need to be
fear of acceptance.
Need to be needed. All right. So let's look at the top. The capping emotions are going to be issues to do with guilt. You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
Issues to do with guilt, because whenever somebody wants me to do something for them, I then go ahead and do it for them, even though I might not feel within myself that I can handle it. So right at the moment, your property, with your property, this is what's happening. Everyone's coming along, they all enjoy your property, and you get something about that. There's a feeling you're getting it from that.
Yeah, I do.
A feeling of joy that you get from that.
Yeah, I have carers there on retreat, and they go away feeling really good about themselves and happy, and there you go. So I feel like I'm making a difference.
Yeah, so you're addicted to that feeling.
Yes.
Right, that feeling. Now, why would we become addicted to a certain feeling within us? Because we don't have it there within us already. So at the moment, you want to over-nurture people, and the reason why you want to over-nurture, which is the creation of the breast cancer, the reason why you want to over-nurture is because you don't want to face the truth that if you didn't over-nurture, you would actually feel that nobody loves you. You follow me?
Yeah.
So the underlying emotion that's driving it is this feeling that really I'm unlovable unless I work for my love. Unless I work to be loved.
Yeah.
All right? And how many women have that emotion? Like, look, yeah, it's a big emotion, isn't it, facing many women?
Yeah.
And it's a multi-generational injury as well. And created a lot by their men not truly caring for them and loving them.
I can see that in my mother before she died. I could see that, and she started this property with me. I could see that, and I thought I was better than that. I thought I'd improve on that. She didn't get breast cancer.
So what's the ego saying? I'm this thing, when in reality, what's the law of attraction saying? I'm something different over here.
So
right?
It's genetically passed? Is that what you're implying, sorry?
Emotions are genetically passed. When you say genetically,
the mother
feels a certain emotion that's passed down to her child. And what's happened is you're being more sensitive to that emotion than your mother, which is the reason why you now have the breast cancer when she didn't. You follow? So she was quite detuned from her own emotional state, whereas you are more in tune with your emotional state, right? But still in a state of error or fear. Right? And that's what creates these illnesses and sicknesses. That's why there's more illnesses and sicknesses now than there's ever has been.
Yeah,
right. There's a lot more breast cancer now than there's ever has been. There's a lot of diseases now that were unheard of even 100 years ago. Right? And the reason why is because the generation now is a lot more sensitive to emotional disharmony. So it's not a condemnation, it's actually a good thing that you're sensitive. The key now is how much pain do you need before you confront this fear of the reason why you over-nurture. Does that make sense?
Yeah, okay, but how do you get from here to there? That's what I'm trying to do. How do I, like, I've got my property on the market, I'm looking for a nice quiet life just on my own.
Can you see straight away what you're doing is you're trying to physically solve the problem?
Yes.
How many of you try to physically solve your problems?
Yeah.
It doesn't work.
No.
Have you noticed that?
Yes.
So we need to come to learn to do what? Emotionally solve every problem. How do we emotionally solve any problem? Experience the emotion. All right. So how would we go about experiencing this particular emotion? Well, one thing we could choose to do is to not nurture anybody anymore. You're about to do that. For 3 months.
3 weeks off.
3 weeks. Okay. I mean, not anymore, ever.
Yeah, but I can't afford to do that because the money side of it won't happen if you don't nurture people.
Yeah, see, that's a justification of the fear.
But that's justified fear, isn't it?
No. Can you see in practice, this is a lot, this gets hard pretty quick.
It does.
You can see that? And I'm saying the truth, no, it's not an issue. You will find the instant you deal with the emotion, all of the attraction, so let's look at the emotion with the money issue. The instant you deal with that emotion, all of your attractions will automatically change and you'll get whatever you need.
It's coming to me now. I'm finding money in my purse that wasn't there.
Yeah, but don't intellectualise this. You've still got the fear. You're worried about... You're saying, I'm going to give myself 3 weeks off, recover from the operation, a bit of chemo, they're going to give you a bit of chemo.
No, I don't
know
any of that.
Okay, so staying away from the chemo.
Just the operation.
So I'll recover the operation, then I'll get back into things.
Well, I'm only going to get back into things as a means to an end.
I know. And do you know what that is? That's called prostitution.
Well, it's not very lucrative. It's doing nothing for me. Okay.
So maybe you need to change the form of prostitution, is that what you're saying?
Once you create something, though, okay, I've created the breast cancer, mm-hmm. I've created the property,
mm-hmm.
I've had the meltdown a couple of weeks ago,
yes.
I've felt the emotion of being very alone and very weighed down and all that, and the guilt of creating this in myself even, you know, and that's gone now.
But none of that was causal.
None of that was...
Well, none of that was causal emotion. The emotion that's creating your breast cancer. All of it was effect emotions. Can you see the difference between a causal and an effect emotion?
Yeah. Yeah.
A causal emotion will actually deal with the reason why you over-nurture. And you're not dealing with that emotion yet.
Mm.
What you're dealing with is, you know, crying about the fact that, you know, you've got the breast cancer, the fact that you've now burdened down with these burdens and all those kind of things. They are all effects. None of them are going to change the situation. They help you access your situation if you let them. But they're not going to change it. What you're going to need to do is step into the causal emotion. Causal emotion is, I over-nurture, why? That's the causal emotion. And fear is dominating that part of you. Right? Fear is the creation of your breast cancer. Fear is dominating that causal emotion.
So I need to turn into a person that doesn't do anything for anybody, is that what you're saying?
No.
But it does for yourself.
What just happened?
Flight.
Can we get out the list? you remember which one?
I don't understand.
That's okay.
How to get from here to there.
That's okay, and I'm not laughing at you. What you're doing is beautifully pointing out to everybody through your example what's going on inside of us all. Right. So this is beautiful. So which one of those did you just do? Okay. Which one of the what do we do when in fear list just happened?
Intellectualise the way.
Go down the list a bit further, you'll find there's another thing there. So what was your comment again?
I need to turn into the opposite to what I am, and that is somebody who doesn't really care about other people's situation.
So I'm saying... So is AJ saying that she needs to become a person who doesn't care for anybody?
No.
But that's the feeling you have. That's the feeling you have. Why do you have that feeling? Because you want to get away from the emotion. So you're going to come up with these ideas, one after the other, after the other, after the other. Oh, AJ's really saying that I shouldn't be loving anymore. Is that what I'm saying?
No.
But I'm going to want to believe that so that I don't have to face the causal emotion. You see, when we create an illness inside of ourselves that is killing us, there is a huge resistance to facing a causal emotion. That's an important thing to understand for all of us.
Can you say that again?
whenever we create an illness that's killing us, there is a huge resistance to feeling a causal emotion. Do you follow that?
Yes.
There's a huge resistance. Now, we will, in our resistance, do all sorts of things. Mm. We will do what you just did, which was actually you tried to throw a furphy at me, if we could call it that. Yeah. Basically, you were condemning me. You didn't feel this, no, but you were actually saying to me that I'm now promoting no love for anyone else. But I'm not, am I?
No, I was just trying to work out how I've got to be.
No, no.
I'm trying to get there.
What's happening is you're trying to intellectualise yourself over the emotion again.
Okay.
We need to come back to the emotion. Remember I said the emotion was I'm over-nurturing everyone around me, including my property. Mm. Right? I'm over-nurturing everything. I do that because I'm addicted to a feeling that's empty inside of me. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to feel that feeling. Mm-hmm. There's a feeling inside of you right at this moment that you are trying your damnedest. Mm-hmm. And you're even willing to kill yourself to not feel it. No, I'm being serious.
Yeah, I know. Right. How do you get beyond that?
How do you get beyond that? Yes. Well, the first point is to get into a state of awareness that that's the truth. You follow me? Remember, your fear always, now this is something I want to talk about a little bit more. Your fear is the pathway home to truth. Right? So you would have found out that you're over-nurturing if you had let yourself feel your fear. So instead of acting upon your fear, let's say you sat down one week and you decided that for 3 months you'd have no one come to your property and you would have you won't nurture anyone just for 3 months. You'd do that. Let's say you decided that right today. What would be your fears that start popping up? You've already mentioned some.
Well, I probably stuff up the figures for the property and I never sell it.
Okay. I'm not going to sell the
property. In reality.
I'm not going to sell the property if I do that. What's underneath that?
I'm not going to get to where I'm trying to get to, and that is sell my property and get myself into it.
But do you really want to sell your property?
Yeah, I do.
No.
No,
your decision to sell your property is actually based on a fear.
No, I've got a really good life planned. I've got things I'd like to do.
Why can't you do that and keep your property?
Enough money to do it.
Ah, so there's another fear. Can you see there's another fear? Mm-hmm. Right?
Okay.
So the truth is, you created this property and you're quite proud of it, right?
Yes.
And why wouldn't you want to hold on to it? The only thing that's stopping you is because of these other fears. The fear that you're not going to be able to pay your debts, the fear that you're going to be overburdened, your cancer is killing you, and you know, that's what it feels like inside of yourself. This property is killing me, you know, I'm not, you know, and there's all these things going on.
Yeah, I don't know, you know, I'm ready to hand it over, I'm ready for someone else to come in. Because I can see my ute driving up the road with my clothes and books in it.
Because you want freedom, don't you?
Yes.
Okay, so why can't you have freedom even if you've got a property?
Because people keep coming there.
No, you keep attracting them. You keep attracting them.
But that is the nature of the business. That is the nature of this business.
Which you created.
Which I created.
Yeah. Why did you create it? Because
I created this property to make a place for people to come and change their lives.
Yeah, you're addicted to over-nurturing.
Yeah. Yeah, but is that something wrong with that?
Yes.
I don't understand why there's something
wrong with that. How do I know there's something wrong with that?
She's
got breast cancer.
Yes, exactly.
The law of attraction is telling you there is something wrong with that.
Yes.
Right.
It's not loving to yourself. So you're not in a state of love of self. That's what the law of attraction is actually telling you. Every time you feel pain, every time you are in a state of pain, personal pain, you are being told by God, through God's laws, that you are not in a state of love. You just think it's love. So at the moment you have this deep belief and many of you have met Gloria too, right? Gloria's not here today. Gloria has breast cancer too. And she has exactly the same emotion that you have. the emotion of want to over-nurture to my own detriment. You follow me? And you'll find that every single woman who has breast cancer, if you talk to them about their lives, they'll all feel a very, very similar emotion. Right? Now, the reason why is because you're addicted to doing this. You're addicted to taking this action that you believe is loving. But it's not loving because the proof is that you're having pain created because of it. You follow me? If I've got pain being created because of something going on inside of myself, then whatever I think is loving is not loving. I'm being told in no uncertain terms, actually, that it's not loving. So this belief that you have, that you need to create this environment, or that you wanted to create this environment, and you were going to over-nurture people to your own expense, and you're addicted to getting an emotion back of joy that comes back when they feel benefit from it. All of it is an unloving transaction. Because if it was a loving transaction, you would not be in any pain. Mm.
Mm. Okay. Well, I say again, how do I get from that? If that's my reality, and if that's what I see the world as being, how do I change my psyche in that?
Well, let's just call your psyche you.
Yeah, how do I change me?
How do I change me? There's only one way to change me. What's that?
Feel it.
Sit in them and...
But it has to be what kind of emotions that I'm feeling?
Causes.
Okay. All right. So what kind of emotions are you feeling mostly at the moment? They're all the effects of what you've created.
Yeah.
But they're not the causal. The causal emotions will be related to your childhood. And how this feeling of over-nurturing, this addiction that came about, right, for you to try to do what everybody else wants so that you could get something in return, the feeling of love that comes from them. And in fact, if you consider right at the moment, it'll be so strong in you, this emotion, that if you considered right at the moment for 6 months just not doing anything for anybody, right at the moment you'd just go into a state of panic about that. And the panic state... This is the fear state that we live in. The panic state will start saying, oh, but what about the property and how much, what, it's not going to sell, and all these things, all these thoughts start flying around, right, in my head about all these different things that I'm starting to panic about. What's going to happen to me? I can't support this property. I need to get rid of this property. And I'm starting now to get into this really agitated state, right? And that is because we still don't want to feel. We're so afraid of just feeling the underlying emotion, and we don't believe that once we just feel that underlying emotion, everything around us will automatically change. We don't believe it. So you love what you're hearing, but you're not believing it yet. Here.
I'm just seeing the different aspects here. Like, okay, if I say I'm not going to do... Like, I'm looking to create my life now so that I don't do anything for anybody else, right? I'm looking to do stuff for me now.
But there's nothing stopping you from doing that and having this property. I'll give you a different scenario. One year from now, if you deal with the emotions, yes, that you'll actually have attracted 3 or 4 people who want to look after the property for you, that you'll actually be able to leave the property whenever you want and come back to it whenever you want. And in fact, you may have 2 or 3 of these kind of properties that you just flip from one to the other about. And you might have, in fact, 1 or 2 of them around the world.
Well, I've sort of created it already because my cousins have sold their property and moved in with me.
Can I stop you, Karen?
Yeah.
You didn't hear that. It went just like... It went straight in one ear and straight out the other.
I don't really want 3 or 4 of them. I want to get myself a little train and live in that.
I know. And you know why?
Why?
Because you're afraid.
You don't trust it.
And the truth is, and this is one thing I realised that for myself, is the truth is, what's to stop you all having 20 properties?
Mm.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing.
One emotion.
Right? Just emotions, that's all, right? Yeah. Nothing's going to stop you from having 20 properties, right? And having lots of people look after each one for you, and all you do is just visit.
Yeah.
Nothing's stopping you from doing that. Nothing. Mm. Right? Just emotions.
So you're saying giving up all those emotions, then you have it all.
That's right. Everything comes to you. That's what I meant by seek first the kingdom and all these things will be added to you.
What's
right?
The core emotion blocking us from having the 20 properties?
There's someone who wants one of your properties.
to get to the core on the effects,
mm-hmm.
I've heard the word lonely and I've heard the word mother
mm-hmm.
and starting the property together with your mother
mm-hmm.
and what that represented to you and whose original idea was it? Was it both shared or, you know, was it, could it be guilt?
It's a lot to do with guilt.
All that sort of stuff and to look at what you actually hear yourself saying in your effects to then start defining what may be the core.
But see, what happens when we get in pain is we start trying to find manual or physical solutions to what our problems are. So we start trying to say things like, the reason why I'm in the state I'm in is because I've got this property. But that's not the reason why you're in the state you're in. Why are you in the state you're in? It's because I've got this emotion inside of me that all of this situation is just perfectly exposing. Follow me? This situation is perfectly poised where you can't sell your property, you've got breast cancer, you can't pay for your property. So you're in this situation now, this bind, shall we call it, this is how you feel about it. But in reality, it's not a bind. It's actually the perfect situation to confront the depth of your emotion, of your guilt towards over-nurturing others. All right? That's the truth. That's the truth we don't want to accept, but that is the truth.
What action do I take now? Like, I know you might think I'm not listening to you, but I don't. I can see what you're saying, so now I say to myself...
I would go home and not take any action except one. Feel the causal emotion that causes you to over-nurture others. To really
how do you do that?
There is a hole in your soul that finds it.
How do you do that?
Yeah.
Well, we'll talk about some practical ways to do that in a minute.
I mean, I can see the scenario in my childhood. I knew I became a pleaser.
Yeah.
I know that.
But see, this is what we all do. We say, I know it, but I'm not feeling it.
Yeah, that's
right. It's only when we feel it and grieve about it that we now really know that that was the creation and it also has left us. You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
It's only when that occurs. So you can say, I know all about that, all you like. It's not going to change a single thing.
Yeah.
It's only when you allow the complete experience of what wasn't experienced when you were little. How did that little child feel about, you know, all these expectations and projections and, you know, things happening towards it? How did you feel when you were little going through all that? You need to experience those emotions that weren't experienced then. They are frozen from them. And they are creating everything. They are creating your entire reality.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth is, what will happen is as soon as you deal with that emotion, things will start changing. The instant you deal with that emotion, things will start changing. But at the moment, you're doing like most of you are doing, aren't you, really, if you think about it. You're trying to find these intellectual solutions to the problem that you're in, right? And I keep saying the same thing. There is no intellectual solution. It is all the soul's emotion creating it. And the only thing that's going to create something different is for your soul's emotion to change. So the truth is that in 3 months' time you could be completely healed from breast cancer, right? Without anything external happening to you, without taking any pills and without eating anything specific, anything special or anything like that. All you need to do is release that emotion that created it. That's all you need to do. The truth is the same with your property. At the moment, you're in over $1 million worth of debt. But the truth is, the moment you deal with this emotion of over-nurturing others as well, you'll find that all of a sudden, everything will start just smoothly occurring to actually resolve that issue of debt, and you won't even consider yourself to be in debt. Right? But only when you deal with the emotion will that occur. You see, what happens is that every time we are in truth, all of God's laws all operate in harmony with what we desire. You follow me? But every time that I am in error, all of God's laws are set up to confront my error. So I'm going to feel like I'm pushing wheelbarrows up hills, or even pushing bigger, you know, semi-trailers up hills in my life, while I'm trying to work opposite to God's laws. Right? So when we're in a state of truth, all the laws work in harmony with our condition to expose the emotion, and when we feel the emotion, all of a sudden everything harmoniously changes. But if I don't do that, then I'm working, trying to make decisions, and in the end, nothing seems to work. How many of you feel like nothing is working, no matter what you do? A lot of people feel that in their life, right? Yeah. In reality, of course that's the case, because it's the emotion being exposed that needs to be felt. That's what everything is governed towards. God created this universe so that you cannot escape your emotions. Right? A perfect universe. And at the moment, you're trying to escape the emotion. The emotion of the child of creation is being escaped by over-nurturing others and getting this pleasurable feeling back from them when you do that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And once that occurs, you've become now addicted to that transaction so much that you're willing to overextend yourself so much and over-nurture so much that you're actually willing to create complete disharmony in your own body to continue doing that. And that's the truth of your current state. And if you allow yourself to feel the fear, it will lead you to that truth.
Okay.
Right? But not act on your fear, I mean feel them. So, as soon as you have that thought pop into your mind, like, I can't do what AJ's suggesting because I'll be broke, I'll be bankrupt. Right? That's one of the fears, right? And just go straight into that emotion. What's it going to feel like to be bankrupt? What do you feel like? Nobody cares for you. Nobody. Why isn't anybody helping you? You know, all these different feelings start coming in if you let yourself dig into that. You follow me? But at the moment, all you're doing is saying, oh, I've got to get it sold. I've got to get it sold. I've got to try hard to get it sold. What that's doing is actually doing all these external things, but not addressing the core emotion that created all these external things. And the law of cause and effect is such that if I'm not addressing the cause, I am still going to keep getting the effects. Right? That's what's happening in your life. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Thanks for being brave.
Yeah,
that's not the end of it. I'll pop out and see you later.
Okay.
And we'll talk more.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Carol. So did everyone learn a fair bit out of that?
Yeah.
Who'd like to do another? Let's say we have a break now. I reckon it's... what is the time, actually?
About three.
Yeah, I think it's time to have a break now. Shall we have a break for 15 minutes or so?